mentioned 24, which I think your lordships are not in agreement with. And I will my lords, I think my lords will see that there does not appear to be any pleading in respect of different summary sheets for the same region. There's nothing like that in his pleadings. It's not.
Ask any question about this. Are you sure? No.
My lord,
where they had two,
yes,
the second one sought to correct the first one.
Yes, my lord, I was then cross-examining Mr. Isiedu Nketia.
Yes.
And then I took him through his Exhibit D.
Yes.
And explained away Ayinsuanu, which was in his Exhibit E.
Yes.
Right.
Yes. But not Professor White. It was Mr. Isiedu Nketia, I remember.
That is so. It was Mr. Isiedu Nketia, not Professor White.
That, as I said, I would like to refer your lordship to section 52A of the Evidence Act, which reads as follows. 52A of the Evidence Act. Yes. Related to relevance, but the substantive thing is cumulative evidence. You know, the court in its discretion may exclude relevant evidence if the probative value of the evidence is substantially outweighed by considerations of undue delay, a waste of time, or needless presentation of cumulative evidence. My lord, the large portion of the paragraphs of the statement of witness statement we have sought to attack involve cumulative evidence. Yes. The large part of the paragraphs, cumulative evidence in relation to what Dr. Professor White, the evidence that Dr. Professor White had already given. And then uses it to fill the gaps in Dr. Professor White's evidence or testimony. My lord, we are done.
Our ruling.
All rise.
And that's our election petition updates. We've just seen hours of Mr. Mahama's lead lawyer justify why portions of that witness statement by Roger Metal-Nuno should not be deleted from the witness statement as objected to by Akoto Ampao, lead lawyer for Nanado Dankwa-Akufo-Addo. Supporting that objection, the EC's lead lawyer, Justin Amenuvo. Court is on recess. It wants to determine this matter of the objection, and then it will move on to the cross-examination on Monday. So if you are waiting, hoping to hear Roger Metal-Nuno's testimony, that's been postponed, actually. So that testimony would come your way on Monday. The court allowed him to go for today, and it has said that it will deal with that matter on Monday. So today, really, we've seen arguments why portions of his witness statement, about 23 of those paragraphs, some in parts, largely some of them, the entire paragraph should be taken out. We've seen Chacho Chikata also make strong arguments why they are fundamental to the case and should not be taken out, as argued. The grounds for the objection is that those paragraphs are irrelevant and not based on the pleading, not containing the original petition that was filed. Court is on recess. It would return with a determination on this matter, but that's where I have to leave you. My name is Mama Vioso Abuaje, handing over to Gifty Ando-Appiah. She will continue with this process. Gifty?
We certainly will continue with the process, Mama V. It's been, what, weeks of you doing this? Well, I've seen that you created a file in which you keep the notes. That's pretty remarkable. But it's been interesting. It looks like the entire day has been sucked up with argument over the witnesses' statement. And so we've had to let Mr. Roger Metal-Nuno go. But it was very interesting to see. It was very interesting to see the court do Zoom.
Yeah. Yeah, that's and I guess lawyers, you know, Samson and his colleagues will tell you that these are things they do all the
they
time.
They do all the
but
time.
For us, for the larger population observing, this really would be the first time that most of us would be watching this on television.
Yeah. Many of us wouldn't have thought that this is something that would be done in the court. But it really tells a lot about how far we have come, which is why people have a lot of expectations about changing certain things about our system. If we can adopt to some of these technological changes, then we should be able to change some of the things that we do. But back to what happened in court today. A lot of people are amazed at the extent to which we have had to have this conversation over the witness's statement, 32 page. And the side of lawyers for President Akufo-Addo, as well as Mr. Amenuvo, seem to want so many of them thrashed out.
So, you know, we started the morning with certain paragraphs, not even, you know, where this issue that we're talking about, the initial one had to do with the statement of truth. Okay. And that's just the last piece of sentences after Mr. Roger Metal-Nuno's signature in the witness statement. And that's because what he had said there was related to paragraphs 1 to 16. And they had to deal with the matter of whether or not they should include the rest of the paragraphs. That matter was dealt with.
Okay.
And then, you know, we came to this issue of the objections of certain paragraphs being taken out. That's taking lot of hours.
The entire day.
To the extent that they had to let Roger Metal-Nuno go. You know, he's been unwell.
Yeah.
Reason, really, he's connecting via Zoom on this matter.
Yeah. Well, Mamavi, thank you very much. I'm going to connect with Joseph Akable, who is joining us right now live from the court. Perhaps he'll be able to give us the highlights once again. If you're just joining in, this is our continuing coverage of the election petition hearing. Joseph, are you there?
I'm here, Gifty.
Great to have you. So Mamavi was essentially talking about the statement of truth. Help us understand a bit more from a very layman's perspective. how relevant this conversation that has taken the entire day is to the case, the hearing in general.
And so the point has to be made that once a petition is filed, the petition will simply make certain claims. And once those claims are made, the witness statement becomes the evidence that supports the claims. And so if you make the claim in the petition that no one had more than 50% of the votes cast, someone has to now provide the evidence to show that, look, as a result of A, B, C, and D, no one had more than 50% of the votes cast. Again, if you make the claim that, look, the EC chairperson wasn't fair to us in the discharge of her duties, and that is what accounted for using wrong figures to arrive at a certain conclusion, someone again has to testify to support that. And this person is testifying by saying that, look, we were at a place, we saw mistakes, we pointed those mistakes out to her, but she told us to go and consult our presidential candidate. And when we went, she proceeded to declare the results without incorporating our concerns, even though the constitution requires of her as a public officer to be fair in the discharge of her duties. And so essentially, that is what is being dealt with today, is the evidence that is being given in the form of a witness statement by Roger Metununu is the subject of concern this particular morning, from morning through to this afternoon. And what is being said by President Akufo-Addo's lawyers is to the effect that when you file the petition makes certain claims, and those claims are in summary forms and evidence has to be adduced in the form of the witness statement to support the petition. They are making the case that, look, what is taking place now is that Mr. Roger Metununu and the petitioner for that matter, they have heard the cross-examination that we have undertaken in terms of Dr. Kwesa White and Siedun Ketia, and they have realized that their case is in trouble. And so they are trying to introduce new evidence to respond to the concerns that we have raised in the form of Roger Metununu's testimony. And that is how come they argue that they are seeing instances where there are matters that have only come up in the course of the cross-examination of Siedun Ketia and Dr. Kwesa White and are not in the petition, yet Mr. Chikata is trying to use the back door to introduce them. You heard Mr. Chikata argue that, look, I disagree with you because ordinarily, if Mr. Metununu was to be on the stand and is being cross-examined, and I'm to even re-examine him, or even if I'm to lead him to give evidence, I could actually still make reference to some of the things that have come up from the previous witnesses to ask him that this particular witness came and said A, B, C, D. What do you think about it? And then you have the opportunity to respond to it. And so he's making the point that his testimony must not necessarily just speak to the issues that have been dealt with in terms of what is in the petition. Then he makes the point that, look, in terms of the law that governs the petition generally, it operates in the nature of once I, the petitioner, file the petition, I don't have any option to respond to any other thing again. What happens from there is that the respondents file their responses, and once those responses are filed, the case now continues. I don't have the opportunity to respond to any other thing unless we are doing the legal address at the very end of the procedure. And so when I have the opportunity to bring a witness and there are some matters that have come up in the course of the trial, I should be permitted to address those issues. And again, he says that those are matters that have been presented in summary forms already in the petition. And so what the respondents are seeking to do is to pull down the witness statement of Mr. Roger Metununu. And they are attacking 23 portions of a 32-paragraph witness statement. And so it essentially means that if they have their way, there wouldn't be much in terms of Mr. Metununu's statement that will add a lot of flesh to the petition that has been filed by John Dramani Mahama. And that is how come we've had hours of legal arguments, and you've had Mr. Chachutikata respond to them paragraphs by paragraphs. Because in the event it was the old system where Mr. Chikata would have led his witness to give evidence, what would have happened was that once a question is asked and he answers and the lawyers for the respondents raise an objection, he would have responded to each objection as and when it is raised. But the court is using the approach of filing witness statements, and now the witness comes and the witness statements are adopted, and then if you have an objection related to the witness statement, you raised it. And so that is how come a lump sum number of objections have been raised, and then the option of having to respond to them one after the other has to be carried out. And so that is what has been transpiring this morning for those who are just joining our coverage of the election petition. There are there's a quest to set aside portions of Mr. Ojo Metununu's witness statement. And you saw earlier, he's unwell and he's testifying via Zoom. And so the court discharged him for today, saying that in terms of the cross-examination, will take place on Monday. But for today, it will deal with the objection and rule on it. And so currently, the judges have gone on a recess to consider the issues that have been put out so far and will return with a decision.
So essentially, the business of the day, what was meant to be the business of the day, which was that Mr. Roger Metununu would be examined, has been thrown out the window. That's going to happen on Monday. But there's also the suggestion that Mr. Chashishikata or the petitioner's team are trying to introduce certain things through the back door, certain things which have initially been dismissed by the court. To try to bring it back with the third witness. Help us understand the information, as in what is the content, in terms of what they believe based on the arguments that Mr. Mahama's team are trying to sneak in through the back door.
And so, very interesting point, and it's interesting in the sense that it relates to something that the court dealt with just on Wednesday. It had to do with a request by Mr. Mahama's lawyers that they wanted to inspect originals of pink sheets used by the Electoral Commission to declare results. You recall that the court turned down that request. Now, Mr. Roger Metununu, in the course of his witness statement, mentions that, look, while we had a strong room, they brought two pink sheets for the Eastern region. We are unable to tell when it was presented to us which one is authentic. They brought one at first and later brought another one. And when we compared the two, they had different figures. And mind you, these are duplicates because the originals are at the original level which is sent. And so he is making the point in his witness statement that he can only tell which one was relied upon in declaring the results if the original is produced. And Mr. Kotwampau argues that this is an issue that the court has dealt with already, saying that you are not going to have access to the original. Yet, this witness is providing evidence to support your case that, look, if we are not getting the originals, there are authentication issues that have arisen. And so Mr. Kotwampau says that it's just a ploy that you are using to re-argue something that the court has dealt with already by having a witness now provide additional evidence to say that there were instances where there were multiple sheets. I was in the strong room. I couldn't there and then confirm which one was original, except that I'm giving the original sheet. I can't tell which one is original. And so that is how that particular aspect of the argument went down. And Mr. Chikata again disagreed with that point to say that this is a witness who is simply giving evidence. And his evidence is simply what he has come, it has come to his knowledge and what he can vouch for. And he is saying that he was in a strong room. He was given two documents. He says he looked at the two documents. They represent the same area. There are some agents who have signed on some, they didn't sign on the other. I compared the figures, they were different figures. I say that I can't vouch for it unless I see the original. And so what is wrong with this? And this is the point that Mr. Chikata made in response to that point that was raised by Mr. Akotwampau.
Interesting part of the conversation. And so we're expecting, Joseph, that when the judges return, which should be anytime soon, that they'll be giving us a ruling on this. And I'm particularly looking out for what the judges say about this particular part of the introducing or bringing in the originals based on the arguments that I've made. But Joseph, apart from this, which other detail points to the arguments that Mr. Akotwampau and Mr. Amenuvo make about wanting to bring in things that have been already dismissed, if there's any, apart from the original documents issue?
There's also the bit about discussion about the EC chairperson deceiving them to go over to confer with their presidential candidate, and then the results were declared. That also came up when Dr. Michael Pesawhite was cross-examined. Now, the point that Mr. Kotwampau makes in that regard is that if you read the petition, it only simply makes reference that the EC chairperson is required under Article 296 of the 1992 Constitution as a public officer to be fair in the exercise of her discretionary powers. Now, Mr. Akotoampao says in the petition, it doesn't give any details of how she didn't abide by that constitutional requirement of her. It doesn't give any details of how he failed to stick to that. Yet, in the course of the witness statement now introduced the evidence that she didn't stick to it by way of deceiving us, even though we had raised concerns and she had promised that she was going to address those concerns and that they were legitimate, and so we should go and confer with our presidential candidate, only for us to reach there and realize that she had proceeded to declare the results. And so these are matters that are important that we should address and that we can have a witness testify to. But Mr. Akotoampao insists that in your petition, you should have made reference that these are the specifics of that deceit that was carried out by the EC chairperson, such that we are all put on notice of those particulars. Yet you didn't do that. In the course of cross-examination, those matters have come up, and now you are being told in a new term that he was misled by EC officials to even sign some pink sheets, and aside from that, to deceive by the EC chairperson to go and consult with the presidential candidate, even though that is not a matter that you stated in your petition. And so you are using the back door yet again, according to Mr. Akotoampao, to introduce fresh facts. And so that is by the way of the other issues relating to matters that have already come up, that as far as Mr. Akotoampao is compared, the back door is being used to introduce those matters into the courtroom yet again. And he made a point that it is as a result of watching the cross-examination that has taken place and realizing that the evidence of the petitioner is in shambles, and he used the word bolster, and he says they are trying to bolster their evidence in the form of bringing this particular witness to now address issues that he believes are loopholes that have been pointed out of the other individuals who have been cross-examined so far.
Of there are other people who would assume that once we have had two witness statements and had two witnesses come in the box, even though the John Mahama side had earlier indicated that they were introducing five witnesses, that we go on with what the two witnesses have done. But what we are seeing suggests that at any point in time, the John Mahama team can bring in any other witness until they reach that five limit. Is this accurate?
The point the lawyers explained to us is to the effect that once he filed the petition and indicated that he was going to call five witnesses, it is the five is the limit that he works with. And if you recall, even at the time that Dr. Michael Kwesa-White finished his testimony, even though the court was well aware that they had filed witness statements for just two people, the court, through the Chief Justice, did ask Mr. Chikata that, are you done with your witnesses? Then Mr. Chikata at that point now indicated that, look, we wanted to ask leave of the court in order to have some witness statement or some potential witness come in to testify. And so the point needs to be made that the number that they've indicated is five. If they intend to call any other witness, they would obviously have to ask the permission of the court first to be allowed to put in a witness statement before even being allowed to let that witness come into the dock for the witness statement to be adopted and the cross-examination to be taking place. And so it's not necessarily the case that they can call as many as they want. Neither is it the case that they intend to stick to the five, because they can do less than the five. They are now doing just three. But the point needs to be made that as it stands now, on record, just three witness statements are on record. And so should there be the need for them to call on further witnesses, they would have to seek the leave of the court, i.e. request the permission of the court that they want to call some further witness, and the court would have to now permit them to file the witness statement before those witnesses will be allowed to enter the dock.
Well, that's again, that's interesting. Joseph, would you be able to walk us through once again the other issues that do not border on matters that have already come before the court, which of course no one can argue has been sneaked in through the back door, but other issues that have been raised in today's argument back and forth?
And so from the very onset, and that is for those who may not have joined this coverage from the start, there was a point about paragraph 1 to paragraph 16, and I heard Mama V allude to that briefly before I came on. And the court dealt with that in the form of allowing Mr. Chikata make a request to amend the petition. The point was that the truth aspect of it, affirming that what has been signed in the form of the witness statement are matters that the witness indeed is speaking to it read that he was vouching for paragraph 1 to 16. And so Mr. Akotampa was saying that 16 to 32 are not matters that the witness was confirming. And so the court dealt with that in the form of allowing Mr. Chikata make a request that it should be amended to read 1 to 32. And once that was carried out, the arguments relating to the objection raised to the 23 paragraphs or portions of the witness statement was then raised. And so that is by way of the other matters that have come up in the course of this particular proceedings. But Mr. Rojo Metununu's witness statement essentially recounts what transpired in the strong room. And there was another fresh allegation that came up for the first time in this particular process. He said that in terms of comparing the sheets that the EC published on its website, his analysis showed that about 1,700 votes difference. That is the vote difference between what they were given at the strong room by way of all the pink sheets as compared to what was put on the website. And that is another fresh information that Mr. Akotampa attacked by saying that the court should not allow that to stand because it is in nowhere in any of the documents that has been put out. But I mean, Mr. Chikata disagrees and says the EC has claimed that this is a transparent process. Someone who was in the strong room is coming in to say that, look, the transparency didn't take place when I was raising concerns, but afterwards we have been told I was being transparent because that information has been put on a website. And even in analyzing it, I've realized that there are differences in the figures. Why should a witness not be allowed to adduce such evidence to assist the court arrive at a justiciable determination of this particular matter? And so that is by way of the other matters that have come up in relation to those issues. There's also a reference to Northern Region pink sheets as well, the Northeast region specifically by Mr. Rojo Metununu as well, where there are multiple sheets in that same regard and difference. And he says when he has access to the originals, he could be able to authenticate what exactly was used by way of the declaration of the results.
Well, I'm going to let you go shortly, but just a quick one. Justin Amenuvo seemed to have had a bit of an issue there with whether or not he was aware or his level of awareness of what was going to happen today, because he had indicated that we are here, and these were his words, that we are here because of the magnanimity of the court. Help us understand what that issue he was trying to raise was all about.
He was drawing the court's attention to the fact that, I mean, CI 99 makes the case for an expeditious hearing. Again, the rules that governs the election petition generally indicate that once the petitioner files his petition, the respondents respond, witness statements are filed, they are cross-examined, other witnesses of the respondents are cross-examined, then the case ends. Now, his point is that by the court allowing the petitioner they leave to now call additional witnesses whose witness statements have not been filed, they've now had the opportunity to respond to some of the issues that have come up in the course of the cross-examination, and that is how come the court has now have to deal with the whole day having a back and forth over whether or not to allow some of those statements go through. And so his point was that the magnanimity of the court in allowing for such a request to go through is what has allowed for this current process that the court is going paragraph by paragraph to decide which aspects of it to be allowed to go through. And it was at that point that the Chief Justice now comes to say that that is not a response, because the procedure is that the person who raises the objection, once the person you are objecting something to about responds, you have the opportunity to only respond on a point of law. And so the judges were pointing out to him that what he had just said was not responding on a point of law. But he did make the point that, I mean, that's all what he wanted to say. And Mr. Akotampa, when he came in, also said that he sides with that particular point. It's because of the avenue that the judges offered the petitioner, and that is how come we are at this particular juncture.
Interesting exchanges there. Joseph, I don't want to, get you all worked up and tired. And so we'll take a very quick break while we wait for the judges to return and give us their ruling. Is there anything at this material moment that we should know from your side before we go on the break?
I mean, I guess we are just waiting for the ruling now, and it has the potential to affect what happens on Monday by way of cross-examination. Should the court grant the request and set aside certain portions of the witness statement, it will mean that the work of the respondents are quite easy when they come on Monday, because those issues will no longer be evidence, and they will not have to cross-examine those evidence, and will have to be limited to the other aspects of their testimony. And so, what we need to put across to our viewers and our listeners is the fact that this is an important exercise that affects the evidential value of this particular petition, and that is how important it is. And so the justices have gone on recess to discuss amongst themselves and decide what happens next.
Landed, the judges are just taking their seats right now, so we'll go right now into the court and find out what the ruling is. Remember, our election petition update is brought to you in association with Petrosol. Clean fuel in full quantity is always a delightful experience. Let's go right.
The second respondent counsel has raised objections to various paragraphs from the testimony of Robert Joseph Mertununu, PW3, in these proceedings. The relevant paragraphs, the subject of the objection, are from line 3 of paragraph 4, paragraphs 5, 6, 7, 8, 11, 16, 17, 19, 20, 22, 23, 24, 29, 30, and 31 are objected to on the ground that they are not supported by the pleadings. Paragraph 9, 15, and 18 were objected to on the basis that they raise issues as to authenticity of documents in the election that the court has already dealt with. Paragraph 10 was objected to on the ground that the petitioner is seeking to build a new case. Paragraph 12, 25, and 26 are objected to as reflecting the opinion and irrelevant to the issues in controversy. Petitioner's counsel has argued that the objections are not supported in law because the testimony is premised on either the petition and the pleadings and the answers and prior testimony of the second witnesses, Dr. Pasa White, on the 3rd of February 2021, and the answer of the first respondent herein. We've considered the submissions of both counsel and the testimony and the pleadings in this petition. We are of the opinion that paragraphs 4, 5, 6, 7, and 18 ought to be struck out, and as they have no foundation in the pleadings or supported by the evidence, and the same is hereby struck out. Yes, the rest, that is the remaining paragraphs in the witness statement, are maintained. The petition is hereby adjourned to Monday, the 8th of February 2021 for cross-examination of PW3 at 9:30 a.m. So in fact, apart from paragraphs 4, 5, 6, 7, and 18, the rest of the paragraphs remain. Yes. Please, you have to prepare for your cross-examination when you come on Monday. You are coming at 9:30.
Bro, my lord.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When the first?
My lords, we are most grateful.
For you, the Chief Justice has just given us the ruling. What he says essentially is that paragraphs 4, 5, 6, 7, and 18 are the only paragraphs that have been struck out of Mr. Roger Mertununu's witness statement. The remaining will stand. Now he has adjourned the sitting to Monday. And the business of Monday, when they do come, is for Mr. Roger Mertununu to be cross-examined and etc. He's told the counsels to prepare for that on Monday. Those are still live visuals coming to you from the Supreme Court there. He's just giving a few background on what the arguments have been, etc. The fact that paragraphs 12, paragraph 25, paragraph 26 are opinions and that irrelevant to the issues that are being contested, and they have come to a conclusion that paragraphs 4, 5, 6, 7, and 18, I'll try and read those paragraphs for you, will be struck out because according to the judges, they have no foundation. Let's take a look at paragraph 4. In paragraph 4 of the statement of Mr. Roger Metso Nunu, he says, it is my understanding also that the specific role of the chairperson of the EC as a sole returning officer is provided for in the Constitution and in the same regulations. Prior to her so-called declaration on 9th December 2020, the chairperson of the Electoral Commission did not perform the duties she was supposed to perform in order to be able to declare a winner of the election, as she attempted to do in the entire period after the election on 7th December 2020. She made a couple of very brief visits to the strong room. This is part of the argument that President Akufo-Addo's legal counsel had indicated, that it is about introducing new things apart from what the petitioner had originally filed. And so you heard the judge, you heard the Justice Eniyan Oboah say that this is part of the paragraphs that are being struck out because they have no foundation. That is paragraph four, that deals with how many times, for example, that the EC chairperson herself was present in the strong room. And so the statement was essentially to challenge the basis upon which she made the declaration, which he described as the so-called declaration. Take a look at paragraph five. And shortly, Joseph Akable will be joining us. You also know that right after they finished, the counsels for the two sides, I mean, there are three sides here, but two of the sides, that's the John Mahama team and the Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo team, will be addressing the media in court shortly. We'll be going there as well to take that. But I'm just taking you through the paragraphs that have been struck out. Initially, there were 23 paragraphs out of that 32-page document by Mr. Roger Metso Nunu, which is his statement, his witness statement. 23 of that, the counsel for Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo wanted to be removed, struck out. The judges have ruled. They are maintaining all the paragraphs except paragraphs 4, 5, 6, 7, 18. I've read for you paragraph 4, which had to do with the number of times that the EC chairperson herself was there, the role that she played. Paragraph 5 reads, the EC had a video documentary person recording events in the strong room. And I have no doubt that if that documentary is available in its authentic version, it will confirm what I am saying in this witness statement about things that occurred in the strong room. And when Joseph Akable joined me, you heard him say that some of the things they have said happened were that there were multiple sheets, multiple pink sheets that came from, he's mentioned something about the northern region, about the Ashanti region. So it goes back to the issue about obtaining the original documents that are in the possession of the first respondent, which is the Electoral Commission, which the John Mahama team are insisting ought to be given to them to inspect. So that is what is in paragraph 5. They're talking about a documentary person, a video documentary person who was available, and that if this particular documentary or video is provided, Mr. Roger Metso Nunu is saying that it will support his argument. But it's been struck out. So that is certainly not going to be a part of Monday's discussion. That has been struck out. Let's take a look at paragraph 6. Paragraph 6 says, dedicated fax machines, printers and computers were provided for the strong room that were to receive faxes from fax machines at the regional collation centers in full view of agents of candidates and then projected on an overhead projector in the strong room as the results were received. EC officials manned the fax machines. On 9th December 2021, for many hours, the fax machines in the strong room. 9th December, it looks like a mistake here because there won't be any 9th December 2021. We're not yet there. We're not there yet. Well, I'll find out from Joseph Akable whether or not this part of the statement came up for conversation. But it says that on the 9th of December, for many hours, the fax machines in the strong room were not working. One could see the frustration on the faces of many of the dedicated fax machine EC personnel. The fax transmission was also slow. Now, that has been struck out. That has been struck out as well. Paragraph seven says, instead of that pre-arranged transmission system for the regional coalition sheets to be transmitted to the head office of the Electoral Commission, What happened part of the time was that one of the deputy director of the EC, Dr. Sribo Kweku, would from time to time bring into the strong room what was claimed to be a regional collation sheet. How he got that sheet was not disclosed. That has been struck out. This statement has been struck out. And then finally, paragraph 18. This is what is contained in paragraph 18. In respect of the northern region, we observed two regional result summary sheets were brought into the National Coalition Center strong room. One was without signature. All right, let's quickly go back to the court right now. Dr. Dominic Ayene is addressing the media.
This morning, the petitioner presented his third witness, in the person of Rojo Joseph Metilnunu. And a witness statement prepared and signed by the said witness was filed before the court. And we were expecting that he was going to give his evidence today. The lawyers for the respondents, particularly the lawyers for the second respondent, Nana Dodankwa Akufo-Addo, raised a number of objections to the paragraphs of the witness statement. In fact, they raised objections to 23 out of 32 paragraphs of the witness statement. And the basic objection they raised was that those paragraphs, in terms of the evidence that was sought to be given, did not arise out of the pleadings of the petitioner. But they sought to say that those paragraphs should have been reflected in the pleadings of the petitioner. However, a basic rule of law, which I'm sure was lost on them, is that in pleadings, you plead facts, but not evidence. And we had pleaded the facts that were necessary to ground our petition. And this witness statement was designed to provide evidence in support of the facts that we have pleaded. So, for instance, we made it clear in the petition that the chairperson of the Electoral Commission had acted in an unfair, arbitrary, and capricious manner. And the evidence of Rojo Metilnunu, together with the evidence of Dr. Kwesa White, which I'm sure witnessed the other day on the 3rd, was meant to make it clear the extent to which the chairperson was capricious, was arbitrary, and also unfair as far as the petitioner's case is concerned. And so we were taken aback when they sought to basically throw out the entire witness statement, saying that it was not supported by the pleadings. But as you have seen, I'm sure the court took a different view, and out of the 23 paragraphs in respect of which objection was taken, it was only 5 of them that the court said should be struck out. And for us, that is a great victory. We will not comment on the substantive content of the petition, of the witness statement, because he's yet to be cross-examined on them. And I'm sure on Monday, when we return to court, the cross-examination will take place. And thereafter, if there are any issues arising out of or in connection with the cross-examination, will address you and clarify those issues to your understanding. Any questions?
That once taken out, you should be worried about. It talks about a fax machine not working and someone just walking into the strong room with documents coming from wherever and using it to collate results.
And people walking in with information or faxed documents and so on. That the evidence was meant to make clear
that the systems that they had put in place, because remember that in first respondents' answer, the EC said they had put in place a seamless and transparent system for the collation of results. And paragraph 6 of the witness statement, which you correctly identified has been struck out, was meant to say that the system that you call seamless was in fact not seamless, that it was in fact dysfunctional, and that the fax machines were not working and there was frustration in the strong room. Of course, that is not the only evidence that we are providing. The rest of the paragraphs detail whatever it took place in the strong room, and we think that ultimately, if those are taken into account, the probative value of what our witness will say will rise up. Any more questions?
Thank you.
Pardon? Well, of course, if the objection was taken to almost the entire witness statement, you know, if you watch Akodo Ampa on his feet, he listed 23 out of 32 paragraphs to be struck out. Now, if you take those that remained, say paragraphs 1 to 3, those are just introductory paragraphs about who the witness is and so on and so forth. So basically, if the entire 23 paragraphs were struck out, then it would have meant that, you know, we would have basically an empty witness statement that would not be supportive of our case. But here's the case: we have, you know, only 5 out of the 23 being struck out, and for us, those 5 do not materially, you know, damage the case that we are seeking to make by bringing Rojo Metilunu as a witness in this matter. So that is why I'm saying that it was a victory for the petitioner as far as we are concerned.
Thank you very much. Forgive me for my ignorance, but I believe that the petitioner came to court to prove a point. The point being that neither of the two leading candidates attained more than 50% of the total votes cast. Now, the witnesses we've seen so far have spoken to other matters other than the figure 50% or less. Even today, the witness statements that we have seen does not address the issue of whether somebody attained 50% or less. Are you shifting the goalposts?
I don't think so. I don't think we are shifting the goalposts. And then, also, first of all, in his testimony, PW1, the general secretary of our party, all right, testified to the issue of whether or not any of the candidates cross 50%, the 50% threshold as required under Article 63 of the Constitution, all right? And of course, you saw that they brought calculators and sought to get him to calculate figures, you know, showing how many votes were won and so on and so forth. So that is what when we addressed you, we said that is the mathematics of Article 63. But this case is not only about the mathematics of Article 63. The case is also about the constitutionality of the conduct of the Electoral Commission, chairperson. And then also, more materially, about whether and the extent to which the declaration that she made is constitutional. Okay, that is an important point that we keep emphasizing. But it looks like there is an attempt in the media to reduce this case only to one issue that we have brought to court. It is not only one issue. There are weighty issues of law that the Supreme Court is being invited for the first time in the history of our constitutional democracy to determine. We underscore the point that this is the first time in the history of our democracy that a chairperson has declared a person president-elect based upon one set of figures, and then subsequently repeatedly revised those figures The question is, and I keep saying, you cannot, can you put something on nothing and expect it to stand? It will not stand. And we are asking the court to declare that her conduct in terms of revision did not comport with law, did not comport with the Constitution, and therefore should be that declaration together with the president-elect declaration instrument, CI-135, should be declared null and void and of no effect. And that has constitutional consequences. Of course, we cannot comment on the constitutional consequences because that is left to the court. But we are inviting the court to declare that her declaration, together with the instrument based upon which that declaration is now law, and for which reason Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo was sworn in as President of the Republic, are unconstitutional. That is an important point that you in the media must bear in mind. Any other questions?
Now, the last time when Dr. Kwesi White tested before the court, your colleagues on the other side were saying that if indeed Rojo was the one who the EC chair spoke to, he should come testify. Now he has come, and per the paragraphs that your colleagues on the other side were asking that be struck out, is there an indication that they will not be comfortable having Rojo testify before the court?
Well, that is a very obvious point, in the sense that they were saying Professor White, you know, basically was giving hearsay evidence. Now the person who was, in the strong room with him and who can corroborate what he's saying is being invited to give evidence. And the same people who said Rojo Metinunu ought to have been called are now saying that he should not, you know, be allowed to present evidence in full in respect of the facts that, events that took place in the strong room. Now, I'll leave that to your judgment, and I wouldn't want to go beyond commenting on whether or not, the evidence that, he will give will corroborate what Professor White, provided to the court. All right, so.
Let me do that quickly. Okay.
Dr. Dominic Ayene there, who has been addressing the media. So key points that he makes before he even talked about responding to some of the questions. He makes the point that even though five of the paragraphs in the witness statement have been struck out, it does not materially damage their case. Now, here is what he started saying. He said that the counsel for Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo that sought to remove 23 out of the 32 paragraphs that they brought as witness statement essentially wanted to say that the entire statement was empty. Because out of those 32 statements, there were a few of them, especially at the beginning few paragraphs that were basically Mr. Rojo Metinunu's explanation of who he is, or introduction of who he is and explanation of his role in the elections. That took about three or so paragraphs. He says, if you wanted to take 23 out of that, you add the parts that the statement, the witness introduces himself, etc., it means that you are left with nothing. But they are calling this a victory. The John Mahama team is calling this a victory because they say you asked for 23 to be taken out. The judges have decided that out of the 23, only five, which means that about 18 of the rest are all have all been upheld, which means we have had victory. He goes on to say that even with this victory, we are confident that with the five that have been taken out, which I read, I gave you, are 4, 5, 6, 7, and 18. With all these, if you take them out, it will not materially damage our case at all. He says that he wouldn't want to comment on the substantive matter because there's going to be the cross-examination of their witness, the third witness, Rojo Metinunu, on Monday. So he wouldn't want to go into it. But regarding paragraph 6, he makes the point that the EC, essentially, the first respondent, had made the point about a similar system that they put together for the election. But that, okay, let's go right now to the court.
Remarks from our side as we wind down today's activities. As I mentioned, it's been long, but it's been a necessary exercise of going through some objections and then hearing the responses and having the court make a determination of what it would allow and what it would not allow in the witness statement. Let me start by recapping where we are in this trial and why we are here. The petitioner, Mr. John Dramani Mahama, former president of the Republic, invoked the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court, among other things, to say that based on the data contained in the declaration of the first respondent, and the second respondent being declared as president-elect of the Republic of Ghana, no candidate will obtain more than 50% of the valid votes cast, as required by Article 63.3. The petition also essentially makes the argument that the threshold of Article 63.3 was not met, and that the declaration was in violation of Article 63.3. Goes on further to say that there were errors and mistakes and other things which will materially affect this election, and outlined five witnesses who would help adduce evidence to prove same. We all witnessed Mr. Johnson Asiedu Nketia come into the witness box and give testimony, and I think the jury is out on whether or not he was able to establish any of these things. And then we had Dr. Kpesa White take the witness box and mostly lead evidence to the effect that they considered that they were deceived by the EC chair to leave the strong room when the national or the presidential final results were being collated. Indeed, the word he used was that he was instructed, and subsequently he admitted that he cannot be instructed by the EC chair. Now, today, the petitioner introduced a third witness, Mr. Rojo Metal Nunu, who was one of those two in the strong room, who is the one that we were all expecting would take the witness box initially. And there were a number of paragraphs that he had outlined that he wanted to adduce before the court, some of which we objected to. In the end, the court upheld what we believe are some of the most substantial ones, paragraphs 4, 5, 6, 7, and 18. The court upheld those ones and struck it out. On Monday, we are coming in for cross-examination. Like they say, it's one thing putting something before the court, it's another thing defending it when it comes to cross-examination. And so counsel on our side, and we believe counsel on the side of the first respondent, look forward to an opportunity on Monday to now put the paragraphs that have been admitted in Rojo's witness statement to the test under cross-examination. Essentially, that is what has happened today, as I'm sure you are aware. We are happy that finally Rojo will be in the witness box so that some very important questions can be put to him and the bench or the court can take judicial notice of whether or not those answers to those questions and those arguments that are being proffered go in any way to help deal with the issues before the court. And as I wrap up, let me take you through the issue. Sometimes when you follow the long conversations, you forget what the court is trying to answer. The court is answering one question of law, three questions of fact, and one question of law that arises as a result of a fact. The question of law is whether or not the petitioner in his petition has any reasonable cause of action. The questions of fact are whether or not, based on the data, nobody got 50%, whether or not the Article 63.3 threshold was met is a question of law, as I've mentioned earlier. But whether or not you include or exclude Techi Mansaut, does it change? And then the other question of fact is whether or not all the so-called errors and vote padding affect the outcome of the presidential election results. The last question of law, which comes from fact, is whether or not the declaration will therefore be in violation of Article 63.3. If you find that at all material times Nana Akufo-Addo exceeded the 50% threshold, then that question of law will be answered in his favor, that then it was not unconstitutional. So we believe that we are making progress gradually. We are at a point where the third witness will be put in the box, and we'll see whether his argument stands up. What is interesting to note is that when our colleagues don't get a win in the wells of the Supreme Court, when they come, they say their decisions don't make sense, that the court is not being fair to them, etc. But today, you notice that as they got some of their arguments upheld, they seem to think that the court is the best so far, but we'll live to see what is out ahead of us. They describe it as a great victory. And let me explain to you why they describe it as a great victory. They describe it as a great victory because they realize that Dr. Petsahwai's testimony fell flat, could not stand the test of time. And therefore, they've tried to bring in Rojo, who initially they came with some reasons not to bring, so that he can, and if you listen to the arguments of counsel for plaintiff, Mr. Chachuchikata, he makes the argument that during cross-examination, some very significant damage was made to the argument. And therefore, it is proper for them to bring in Rojo to try and re-establish some of those ones. So for them, if many of them had been struck out, it would be a very devastating day, because then it goes to buttress the point that where Rojo failed, where Petsahwai failed, nobody can attempt to save him. Now, they seek to bring in Rojo to try and save Petsahwai where he fell flat. And we are pleased that at least they are no longer trying to poison the minds of the public against the court. We look forward to what Monday will bring. We'll take your questions.
Right, so the first question I ask is that today in court, after lawyer for the
Right, so the first question I ask is that today in court, after lawyer for the petitioner finished his submissions, we saw the lawyer for the Electoral Commission, the first respondent, making an argument that it appears the court seems to be going a certain direction in a petition where they are allowing the petitioners to speak before the respondents, when it's supposed to be the petitioners first before the respondents. Mm. Is this something that you identify with as second respondents? Because I didn't hear your lawyer talk about That's it. Are true. You going to raise issues with it?
That's true. Well, let me quickly respond to that. What the counsel for the first respondent said was to draw the attention of the court to the fact that the procedure as it's unfolding, it appears to be deviating from the norm. The norm is that the petitioner makes his case first, and then the respondent responds. And even by CI 99, you are not allowed the opportunity of a reply. If you look at witness statements, for example, the petitioner refused the orders of the court to file the witness statement. What it meant was that the one responding rather put in his witness statement, as did the first respondent, and the petitioner then had opportunity to read it and attempt to now put in witness statements. So it's like the respondent is now going ahead and the petitioner is looking to how to close their gaps behind. In the case of calling witnesses, properly so-called, you will notice that at the deadline for filing witness statements, Rojo Metunu's statement was never filed. They came to see the justices in chambers and made an application, which we didn't object to because we believe there are some questions he must answer. But what has happened is that after Petsahwai has been cross-examined and his case has fallen flat, then they bring in Rojo seeking to correct or salvage some part of that case. It is that which the counsel for the first respondent is drawing the attention to the court, that that is not the normal practice, and that they are literally allowing the petitioner to turn the rules upside down. I think it's obvious that the court is being very magnanimous. In fact, he used the word magnanimity. The court is being very magnanimous in hearing all sides and allowing things that ordinarily it will not allow. But, like we keep saying, always go back to the issues. What are the issues that the court is seeking to answer? And we are of the view that whatever things about fax machines not working, about phone call that they couldn't hear from, and then about deceit and a few other things, whether or not it changes 4751.2, or it changes the constitutionality of Article 633, something that the bench will determine eventually.
Right. I have this simple question. Yes, that was on Wednesday. You asked.
You said, speak up, sir, so that we can hear you.
On Wednesday, you said that the court is a place of law, and then on your previous interviews, you also made a statement that justice. Denial of justice is delayed of justice. Or, I don't know.
No, I haven't said that.
Delayed. Yes, exactly. Sorry. And so with that, putting law and justice together, if each of them is contradicting each other, which one do you choose, law over justice or justice over law?
Well, in the end, the court seeks to do justice and seeks to do it in accordance with law. Justice must be done, but justice must be done in accordance with law. You cannot do justice outside the law. That would be extrajudicial attempt to establish justice. We've had a history in our country where some people have elected that they don't want to do things in accordance with the law. They have executed people without due process. They have confiscated properties without due process. We have now come into a democratic era. So everything, including justice, the rule of law, is hinged on the Constitution and is hinged on law. So justice is what we expect to be done in this manner, or in this matter, and we expect that it will be done in accordance with law. That is why whatever prayers we have, we'll say it before the court, they will rise, think through it, and then they will come back. What we must not do is to bastardize the courts when we don't get our way. And that's why I made the point that you notice that our friends, when they don't get their prayers upheld, they come here and they say, it doesn't make sense. They are not being fair. Today, when some of the arguments are upheld, they literally say that the court is the best court that they have seen. We must be consistent. We've been consistent from day one, that we are in the hands of the court. Yes, sir.
In terms of what transpired today, there are some who look at it and say that your side should be concerned in that the 18 issues that went through were matters that effectively came up during cross-examination. Unfortunately for your side, you've already filed your witness statement. You would only have the opportunity to re-examine your witness and cross-examine the other witnesses. It means that you will not have the window of opportunity to put through and respond to some of the issues that may come up during cross-examination like they had in this particular instance. I mean, that should be of concern to your side.
Well, not exactly. Let me explain to you why. First of all, where are we in this process? We are at a point where the petitioner is still trying to establish his case. The petitioner has not established his case or has not told the court that they have closed their case, that they believe they have substantively made a case before the court. What they've done is to make some pleadings and call two witnesses so far, Johnson Esiedun Ketia, the general secretary and the coordinator of the entire electoral program, who came in, calculator in hand, he ended up with 4751. 4751, plus or minus Techi Mansah, 4751. You never saw him calculate and say, nobody got 50%. Then they moved on to Kwesa White, and you were wondering whether he will also come and perhaps be the one to provide the evidence that will show that nobody won. Because remember, they have told the millions of their supporters across this country that they won. Many of them believed them, got on the streets. They came to court now, they say they didn't win, but nobody won. So you at least you're expecting that one of their witnesses will prove that nobody won, even if you forgive them for the first exercise of deceit of the Ghanaian public and their supporters. Kwesa White gets into the box, and the gravamen of his testimony is that they were deceived by the EC chair. He uses the word instruct to leave. And at the end of his testimony, one question from counsel Akotoampao, I put it to you that you cannot be instructed to leave, he admits, and the whole testimony crumbles. So now you find that they go and bring our very good friend Rojo Metununu, who we were all hoping they would put in the witness box in the very first case, because he was the one granting the TV interviews and claiming in those interviews some things, which I won't say now because cross-examination hasn't started. They are now at a point where they are trying to make their case. It is when they succeed in making a case and tell the court that, my lord, we have closed our case, that a certain threshold may or may not have been met, in which instance we and the first respondents may have an obligation to also open or advance a case. So it's early days yet. Bear in mind that they have made some specific allegations out there. They have to prove it in the court of law. Until then, we don't even have a case so much to make. We are ready. Chairman McMenu comes every day with his pink sheets and his regional coalition sheets and his Form 12s. And is ready that if it becomes necessary that he mounts the witness box and prove that Nana Akufo-Addo indeed got 51.2 and beyond, he's happy to do it. But they have to prove their case first, because he who alleges must prove. Check section 14, section 17 of the Evidence Act. So Rojo will have to now come into the box, make his allegations, prove same, and be cross-examined on it before we move to the next steps.
Your side during Dr. Kwesa White's cross-examination indicated that the petitioner couldn't have brought Roger Mbetinunu because there was no way he was coming to be able to confirm what Professor White was saying. Now, today, your side made an attempt to almost take out the paragraphs in Roger Mbetinunu's witness statement. Now, you are saying that you are happy Roger Mbetinunu is coming. How do you link these two to you saying that you are happy that Roger Mbetinunu is coming to
First of all, let me show you what is interesting. There are supposedly two people who have been sent to go and protect the interest of Mr. John Dramani Mahama, the EC strongroom. Person one is the principal party. Person two is more or less the supporting actor. Person one goes to have a conversation and supposedly reports to person two that both of them should leave. And at the material time when the petitioner wants to adduce this evidence, he opts to bring person two and says person one should come and corroborate. Anybody who is following it begins to realize that something funny is going on here. Because ideally, you will bring in Rojo and then rather look to get somebody to corroborate, assuming his evidence is not enough. They flipped it the other way around, no wahala. But we are happy to have Rojo in the box because there are some questions that will be put to him. That is why on the other day we were saying that perhaps they didn't bring him because they were of the view that if he comes, he will perjure himself. Now he has come, he has tendered in his witness statement. The technicalities of what must be accepted and what doesn't meet the standard have been dispatched with. Now the questions are going to be put to him to see whether his argument, what they tell the NDC supporters, what he told the supporters, whether I can stand the test of scrutiny in court. And that's why we're very pleased at where we are. Remember, a case is now being made, and we are now at the point where we are cross-examining that case. When it is done, if we have to now get into a full response, then we'll get into it. I want to say thank you and invite my colleague Fatih to sum up in chief for us.
And so while Fatih sums up in chi, this is what Mr. Kojopon Krumah, who speaks for the legal team, has been saying so far. He says that they are happy that Mr. Roger Mbetinunu is going to be put in the box because they believe that Mr. Roger Mbetinunu's presence is essentially to correct some mistakes that they believe they had made with Mr. Professor White. They said that they are ready to put him in the box, and they believe that the questions they'll put to him will crumble their case. Essentially, he talks about, he first gives, you know, the recap of what has been happening so far, reminds us of the questions at stake in terms of the question of law and the question of facts. And then he talks about the fact that they are making progress gradually. He's calling out the reaction of Mr. Mahama's team when there's a ruling from the court. And he's saying that today they're happy that Mr. Mahama's team is referring to what happened today as victory for them. But he believes that it is because it went in a way that makes them happy. But anytime the rulings have gone the other way, they go out and according to Kojopon Krumah, they poison the minds of Ghanaians against the judges. He talks about the fact that Mr. Chashichikata, who is counsel for Mr. Mahama, argues that there were significant damages made to the argument made by, or the argument essentially made by their second witness, which is Professor White. And so they are bringing in Mr. Roger Mbetinunu to clean up. And then there were questions that he was supposed to, that were thrown at him. As well, he says that in terms of the petitioner making his case, and you remember the question that I had asked Joseph Akable about what Mr. Amenuvo, who speaks for the first respondent, was saying, who is counsel for the first respondent, was saying that why are they, you know, sort of working out the case in such that the petitioner should have made his case and then they'll take the question subsequently. He's saying that the petitioner is seeking to do what he calls, you know, turning the rules upside down. And then he talks about the issue about the magnanimity. In all of this, he says that they expect justice from the courts. Joseph Akable asked him whether or not they are concerned, given that some of their requests when met today, out of 23, only five were removed. He says that they're not concerned, but the petitioner, as far as they are concerned, is still trying to build his case, is still trying to establish his case, and that they are ready to prove that they actually met, or Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo actually met the threshold, the Article 63.3 threshold, 50% plus one, essentially. So that's the point that he makes there. Kojopon Krumah, that you heard earlier on Dr. Ayene, who speaks for the other side, John Mahama, Mahama's team, making his points as well. We'll be wrapping up with Joseph Akable shortly. But just to remind you, our election petition update is brought to you in association with Petrosol. Clean fuel in full quantity is always a delightful experience. DBS Roofing, we truly are your roof experts. And Coa Mixture, the immune booster for your general well-being. Well, after several years of intensive research, DBS Industries Limited bring you roofing sheets to help complete your dream house in style. Call our hotlines 0240-844-444. � That's DBS for you. DBS Industries, we truly are your roof experts. And due to hard times, we have become value hunters, but are we hunting for value the right way? At Petrosol, we serve clean fuel in full quantity at a fair price, and that is holistic value. So come to us, Petrosol, clean fuel in full quantity. This is the pulse, and we were just taking the tail end of the election petition hearing. We had the judges rule on whether or not some part of Mr. Rojo Metsonunu's statement, witness statement, should be struck out. They have ruled 23 paragraphs with concerns by Mr. Nanadudankwa Akufo-Addo's team, five of them expunged or five of them removed from struck out. Those are the words they use. We'll be right back. Just stay with us. You're welcome back, and this is The Pulse with me, Gifty Ando Appiah. Away from the court, let's go to Parliament, where the members will from next week be allowed to receive visitors within the precinct of Parliament. This is according to Majority Leader and Chairman of the Business Committee of Parliament, Osaiche Mensah Bonsu. Presenting the schedule of business for next week, Osaiche Mensah Bonsu indicated also that only members of Parliament and staff who will be required for sittings and the business of the House will be admitted to Parliament from next week until further notice.
Testing carried out in Parliament and the need for further precautionary measures to avert the spread of the disease. You, in consultation with leadership, have agreed that the House sits only twice a week. Speaker, again, the directive has been given that beginning next week, members would not be allowed to bring their visitors to the House, including their offices. The same directive goes to the staff. And we want to restate the fact that the public would also not be allowed into the public gallery to observe proceedings in the House. Accordingly, the Business Committee has programmed that the House would sit on Tuesday, the 9th of February, and Thursday, the 11th of February, 2021. Speaker, members are entreated to take note of the change in the days of parliamentary sittings to avail themselves for business or plenary on the set date.
Now, that's Majority Leader Osaiche Mensah Bonsu there. So it is that members of Parliament will not be allowed. I indicated that it will be allowed, but it's actually not to be allowed. And you heard the leader say so. He also noted that although the Appointments Committee of Parliament will start vetting President Akufo-Addo's nominees for the various ministries on Wednesday, the committee could be dissolved and a new one constituted depending on the decision that the House will take on the new standing orders. However, he emphasizes that the appointment committee, as presently constituted, will vet the nominees until then.
I think for the avoidance of doubt, it's important to state that there is going to be a new configuration for the appointment committee if we come to adopt the new standing orders. And because we are not there yet, the appointment committee, in its current nature and shape, would then sit on Wednesday to begin the vetting or screening of nominees. Once the rebuild orders is adopted by the House, that committee will stand dissolved, and a new committee will come to replace that committee in the performance or the functions of the appointment committee.
Away from Parliament, the Ghana Education Service says it will increase surveillance in schools. This, the service indicates, has become necessary as it has emerged some heads of schools are refusing to obey COVID-19 guidelines. There have been reported cases of COVID-19 in schools since reopening 3 weeks ago. We'll hear more from the Inspectorate Division at the Ghana Education Service soon. But this afternoon, let's take you to Akosombo International School, where some students have tested positive for the virus. Maxwell has more.
Regular school activities are going on here at the Akosombo International School, where a student has tested positive for the virus. But we are told that it was the parents of the student who first called the school to alert school authorities that they have tested positive for the virus, and it's likely their child is also positive. We're told that after that test, the student tested positive. Contact tracing was done, 500 students were tested, and out of that 500, 42 tested positive for the virus. We are told by school authorities that all the 42 students are currently in isolation. I've been speaking to the medical director of the Volta River Authority Medical Services, Dr. Rebecca Akwa-Ahin. She says mass testing of students and workers are currently ongoing.
Yes, what you heard is true. What the school has done and the health team have isolated all of them. We have started the treatment. They are all on treatment. None of them has any symptoms. And so by the national protocol, once you have a positive, you isolate, you treat, and you also do contact tracing. So we are doing the contact tracing, and we are testing the contacts as well.
So that involves testing of all students and workers?
Yeah, because it's a boarding school, the interaction has been wide. So we intend to test all the students and all the staff, both teaching and non-teaching. And we are ending it today. We want to test all of them today. And once we are still testing, if more positives comes, we will let you know. Once they tested positive, we informed their parents. We have isolated them from the rest of the school, and we have given them the treatment. We called the parents one-on-one to inform them with all those whose child were positive. And we've also informed the staff. The staff who are also positive have also been isolated, and they are receiving treatment adequately. And none of them has any symptoms. Yes, we've put in a lot of measures to curb the possible spread. For instance, the school has been fumigated. The school will now divide the children into two shifts, morning and afternoon. The dining hall, they will also go in shifts so that they don't all join or spread the disease further. We have sensor taps all over the school. We have sanitizers all over the school, and education of the children are ongoing. And we know that with the teachers, we have also put in measures for the teachers to monitor so that whatever we have put in place, the washing of the hands, the social distancing, and all the other protocols are being adhered to. So they are being monitored. We've even decided to include the student leadership so that they will help us when they go to the dormitories. They will help us together with the housemasters to enforce the protocols. Yes, the 42 you heard was right. But like I said, if we finish with it today and there are any more positives, we will let you know.
Director of Human Resources here at the Akosombo International School, Eric Mensah-Bunsu, says the last batch of students and workers will be tested today. He says a grand total of 700 students and workers will be tested as part of the enhanced contact tracing process.
As a concerned parent, my daughter is also here. You know, when the issue came, we were quite surprised, and we needed to find a way to communicate to parents. So what we did was to use our medical team to call each parent one after the other and made sure, you know, we explained the situations to them. Prior to that, we have counseled the students. You know, we've made them feel more at home, especially when they realized that they were not showing any signs, symptoms of that sort. Initially, as a parent, you know, they were a bit worried, concerned. But then it got to a point that even the students themselves were telling, comforting their parents because of the kind of treatment that we're giving to them. And so initially, yes, parents were a bit worried, but now it's better. I think the issue has to do with the negatives, where some parents are a bit worried to find out the status. Because as we said earlier, the program is ongoing. We have to finish hopefully today. Then we'll get a true picture of what is happening. So parents, students who are negative, we haven't come, but when they come, we let them know that their wards are here, they are okay, and that's all. So far, it's been very, very calm. Yeah. If you put all together, we expect to test, you know, about 700, 750, if you ask staff to it, yeah. And so by extension, you know, as we are doing the contact tracing, you move into staff, non-staff, even the security, they are not part of it, we extend to that, and even the vendors, you know. So the number can change, you know, based on the contact tracing and the system that we put in place, yeah.
Lead Inspector of the National Schools Inspectorate Authority, John Kweku Agri, has been commending the school authorities for ensuring that all the students wear their face masks at all times. He is, however, not happy with social distancing in the classrooms. He is optimistic that a shift system that will be rolled out from next week will help resolve the challenge.
So far, they've done well. As you can see, all of them are in their nose masks. And probably one, two. It's only one learner I saw who didn't have any nose mask on. The sanitizers are there, but the posters and the COVID protocols, I think they need to enhance that. And then also the major problem you see here is the social distancing. That one, they are faulted. And like they've told us, from Monday, they are going to do the shift system. And we've also advised them that those in the class, the border should not mix the day learners.
Okay. So that is that coming from you, the National Inspectorate Board?
Yes, we have just they said they were going to do something of a sort. And so that is good. But they should make sure that the day learners do not mix with the borders. Okay. And they are saying that every class, they will go to a separate room as borders. But there's one thing we have noticed there around the Kelvinator, where apart from the fact that they cluster to fetch water, they also press on a knob. And when they press, the next person comes and presses. So they don't sanitize the area before the next person comes. So that for us is a potential source of infection, which we'll communicate to them. They have the sick bay and they have the holding area. So I think for now, all well and good, but the social distancing, who they have promised that from Monday, they are going to run the shift system. That's the major source.
Okay. So are you replicating these checks in other schools in this region and in the district as well?
Yes, from here we moved to other schools, and some of our colleagues are also in other regions as well.
Okay.
So it is not just a one-spot check. Okay. We are doing that across the nation.
What have you gathered on the ground?
I think so far they are doing well. Apart from the fact that it was a parent that informed the school that they have tested positive, so it is likely their child will be. So from there they took it up. And so far they've tested 553 of the school community, teaching staff, non-teaching staff, and learners, which they are still continuing. And they are in league with the district head directorate. Even when they are under resource, they also provide resource for them to help them. But they've not informed us, which is one lapse on their part. They should inform the district director and also inform NASIA and the Ministry of Education as well decided, but that one they've not done, which they said they are sorry. So we've heard that next time these things must be communicated to us immediately so that we can all help to maintain the situation. As you know, NASIA is there for the good of the learners, and we are making sure that the protocols are strictly of them, giving them professional advice as to how to make sure things are well done.
Maxwell Agbagba with that report from the Akunsumo International School. We want to take a general look at how schools are faring when it comes to the supply of PPEs, compliance to the COVID protocols, and also look at the feeding issue, which has also come up as a big deal when it comes to spreading the virus. The executive director of the Africa Education Watch, Kofi Asare, who has also been doing some of the observation works across the schools, is joining me right now. Hello, Kofi. Thank you for your time and good day to you.
Evening and good evening to your audience.
Right. Your general assessment of the schools since reopening, you've been doing some monitoring work. Do tell us.
I think the first 2 weeks, we struggled a bit. People were in delayed supply. But then the teachers were able to manage with the previous PPEs, the leftover PPEs from the last reopening. And schools were able to manage the reopening process. Parents were supported by providing PPEs for their work, you know, until government PPEs started arriving from week two, as we were told. And so the first 2 weeks wasn't as smooth as we expected, even though we admit that teachers did their best to manage the situation by optimizing the PPEs that they had, and then trying as much as possible to ensure that students were wearing their nose mask. On the front of physical distancing, we've not done well, especially in the urban schools and peri-urban schools. We have a situation where there's still sort of a deadlock or a penumbra in respect of whether all schools with class size more than 35 or 30 should run a double shift or not. And that is what has accounted for large class sizes, even as we enter, or even as we are in restraint. It looks as if teachers are not too sure whether they will do any extra remuneration and what exactly they will be giving. Should they accept to split their class into two and teach from morning till evening? Because of that, and the absence of any firm assurance or decision by the Ghana Education Service, their employer, in respect of the remuneration or extra remuneration due then, should they run the shift system? Teachers have largely been hesitant in reporting high class size, the district directors, as was prescribed in the school guidelines. So class splitting is not happening because we have made it in the guideline that it is based on a demand-driven initiative by teachers. So instead of reporting, you have class split and day teaching morning and afternoon, including at 4:30 or 5, most of them prefer to manage the class size of 70 and then close at 12 o'clock for primary schools and 3 o'clock for junior high schools. That is the situation we have on our hands by the end of week three, which is today.
I mean, very interesting observation there. Just yesterday, we were told that 42 students at the Akosomo International School have tested positive. Now, today, our cameras were there, and looking at the visuals that Maxwell, he was in the school. We saw some of the students are in the classroom. It's sort of reassuring. What do you make of the sort of the strategy, if I should put it that way, or how authorities at the school are managing the situation? They said that they've isolated them and they are running mass testing for everybody in the school.
Yeah, we have always encouraged authorities, especially private schools, to be forthcoming with such challenges. Look, we are in the COVID era, even challenge, even White House had infection. So whenever a school has infection, be it public or private, we have always encouraged leadership of the school to be forthcoming and open with their challenges, and let the health authorities come in and administer the case management protocols that need to be managed.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, that is what will ensure that the necessary isolations are made, the necessary disinfestation, if you like, is undertaken, and also ensure that the necessary testing, you know, is done, so that we are all comfortable, okay. Things are comfortable, that there is no hidden risk. of reinfection in the school environment. And so we are happy about the response. We are happy about the efficacy of the school, not only Akosombo International, but also Legacy Girls. We were happy about the initiative they took. They tested a lot of students, and then 13 or so were positive, and then they've taken action. We are encouraging all schools before coming with such information to the health authorities, so that the health authorities can come in and then administer case management protocols to ensure that the lives of the remaining or everybody in the school environment is not put at risk by virtue of delayed reporting or non-reporting of cases. So we are happy about the way it's been managed. I have a strong feeling that the experience of last year for the secondary school, for the boarding school, the experience of last year in our group has
helped us better manage. And
enhance the capacity of our teachers and school administrators to manage the school and enforce health and safety protocols in a manner that we are not hearing the infection the way we were doing in July or August of last year when secondary schools reopened for the first time. And so we will get there gradually, except to say that we are not hearing the tough words, tough instructions which is hearing from the National School Inspectorate Authority. When the officer says they have promised outside with the class, that is unacceptable. We can't be enforcing directives based on promise on the other side. No.
Right.
Directives are issued by the executive for compliance. And so we expect to see a more stringent, you know, approach towards law enforcement when it comes to enforcing the guidelines in relation to physical distancing within the classroom, because that is key in ensuring our school environment for all both teachers and students.
Kofi, thank you very much for your time this afternoon. Kofi Asare is the Africa Education Watch Executive Director there, indicating that it's important for schools to be open and to report honestly, report what is happening in the school so that they can get the necessary help from the education setup. As Akosombo International has done. Away from that, the police in Wa have arrested 83 persons for failing to wear face masks in public. The arrested persons include 17 females, 66 males as well. Although the region continues to record increasing cases of COVID-19, the compliance to health safety protocols remains a big challenge. That has also compelled the police to arrest people who are recalcitrant. Here is a report by Rafik Salam.
Following the fiat from the president a couple of weeks ago, ordering the Ghana Police Service to ensure the strict enforcement of the wearing of nose masks by the people, the Upper West Region's Police Command for a week first engaged in a vigorous sensitization of the people at churches, mosques, and markets on the need to adhere to safety health protocols, especially the wearing of nose masks. The Upper West Region has so far recorded 220 COVID-19 cases. 65 of the cases are active, 4 at a treatment center, 61 attended to at homes, and 8 deaths. Despite the spreading figures of the new cases, the people seemed unconcerned, thereby forcing the Ghana Police Service to this morning embark on a special exercise to arrest persons who failed to wear the nose masks. 83 persons were arrested in the one-hour exercise. Chief Inspector Gideon Borton is the Upper West Region's Public Relations Officer of the Ghana Police Service.
At about 9 o'clock in the morning, the command went out there. We went to some places like KJTR here in Wa, the main traffic light, the headquarters round about here, and then the NIB area. We were able to arrest 83 people comprising 17 female and then 66 male.
Well, still some mass gathering going on there. Hopefully they'll have enough masks to go around when these arrests are made. Here on The Boss with me, I'll take a very quick break. We'll return shortly. And that'll be all for this hour. There's more news at myjoyonline.com. This show is also on demand on our YouTube page. Do link up there. My name is Gifty Andopi, and have yourself a good weekend.